St. Louis is a movie town. We've got everything from the huge megaplex theaters that cater to the blockbusters to the smaller houses where you'll find indie films. You'll find me at both. My name is Dawn Meadows Dixon, and I've been covering movies and working as a film critic for nearly 30 years. I've covered the Oscars on the red carpet, movie premieres, interviewed hundreds of stars, and seen thousands of films. And it's my job to bring a bit of Hollywood glitz and glamour to the Gateway City. Welcome to On the Screen. Hello, everyone. I am Dawn Meadows Dixon, and welcome to On the Screen. My next guest won an Academy Award for An Inconvenient Truth. His new film is He Named Me Malala. Please welcome to the show, Davis Guggenheim. Welcome.
Good morning.
You know, I saw the film, and it's a look into the life of this young girl, Malala, who stood up against the Taliban in the name of girls and education everywhere. How did you get involved in telling her story?
These producers here in Los Angeles who make Hollywood movies got the rights to her story and originally thought it should be a movie with actors. But then they met Malala and they were like, who could play her? You know, she's so extraordinary in real life. So they called me. I make documentaries. And it was one of the great phone calls of my life because I spent the last 2 years with this girl and she's a real deal. She's very special.
You know, I was struck by her peace and her calmness and her maturity. There was a scene in the film where you talked to her about forgiveness, and she says she truly has forgiven her attackers. I'm wondering, what's the most amazing thing you learned about her?
Well, that's one of them. I mean, and some people say they, you know, they forgive people and, you know, that's what they're supposed to say. The truth is that in real life, she does not live in any bitterness. She does not live in anger, and she does forgive them. She's really special, and she now feels like she's an advocate for all these other girls all around the world who are going through what she went through. There are 66 million girls.
There is a moment when you have to choose whether to be silent or to stand up.
Tonight, Malala remains in intensive care.
She was shot in the head for daring to suggest girls should go to school.
The reason why I made this film is because I have two daughters, and I wanted them to feel like they could speak out for what they believed in. And I wanted this unlikely story of this girl from the other side of the world could teach my daughter something about what it means to speak out and to have the courage to raise your voice.
They thought that the bullet would silence us. I am the same Malala.
I'm still 17.
Boy, has it worked. My daughters are just infatuated with this girl. She's so inspiring to them. And that's what's my hope as the movie opens nationwide this week, that girls everywhere will want to go see this film. Parents will want to take their daughters. Daughters will want to take their parents to see this movie.
I, too, have teenage daughters who are big fans of Malala, and the first time she was up for the Nobel Peace Prize, they were following her online. And it's an amazing thing to watch. These young girls all over the world look up to her. I'm wondering if you stay in touch with her.
Every day. I mean, she's really the most special person I've ever met in my life. You know, and to see girls like my daughters, be inspired by her.
You've never felt angry.
This girl who's, you know, 7,000 miles from where we live now. It's really interesting. It makes the world kind of a little closer, a little smaller. Sometimes the only information we get from that part of the world is kind of scary. But this is an inspiring story, and it's kind of a funny story. And it's a real sort of a feel-good story that any girl, any father, any mother could learn from and could enjoy.
You are originally from St. Louis. In fact, your dad is a well-known documentarian, and there is an award at the St. Louis Film Festival in his name. When did you know that you wanted to follow in your father's footsteps and tell stories like this?
Well, you've done your research. You know, I remember my father made the movie that plays at the center for the St. Louis Arch. That's one of his first really great movies, and he was discovered by doing that. He felt very passionate that making documentaries could help change the world. And I sort of learned at his knee. And my sister still works for him. She just helped restore that film that plays at the St. Louis Arch. And it just was great. It was sort of like a great thing to watch my father do. And I dreamt that I could do it too, and it's nice to carry on, even though he's passed away. It's a great feeling to carry on that tradition that he started in St. Louis.
You then go on and win an Academy Award for An Inconvenient Truth. How did that change your life?
Well, it's always good to have a movie that people recognize. To me, the award is not the statue or anything like that. The reward is that people go and see the movie. You know, there's a challenge, I think, to get people to see documentaries. Usually when they go, they're pretty inspired. So my father taught me that documentaries can be inspiring. That they should be good, really good stories, well told. He was really good at that, and that's what he taught me. And that's what I learned from him. And when you see this movie, it's not one of those dry movies. It's a chore. It's actually a kind of funny movie. There's a lot of laughter. There's a lot of inspiration. And at the end of the movie, I think you feel kind of pumped up that you want to go off and change your own world. And so that's really the exciting part of being part of my father's tradition and making these movies. It's a wonderful job that started in St. Louis.
It was great to talk with you, and we look forward to seeing you back here in St. Louis.
Thank you, Don. It's nice to be on your show.
We've been talking with Davis Guggenheim, the director of He Named Me Malala, a fabulous story about resilience and courage. And we'll be back with more on the screen right after this.
I'm a teacher. Let me tell you what I make. I make learning a privilege, not a chore, and frustration a tool, not an obstacle. I make working hard seem easy and giving up impossible. I make an old subject feel like a fresh thought and unconventional methods common. I'm a teacher. I make more.
Hello, everyone. I'm Dawn Meadows-Dixon. Welcome back to On the Screen. Two new films open over the next month that'll attract two very different audiences. The first is called Spotlight, the story of the Catholic Church's cover-up of the child molestation cases in Boston. And the second, Love the Coopers, the first of many Christmas films that will surface between now and the holidays. Here's my take on both.
I know there's things you cannot tell me. But I also know there's a story here, and I think everybody will hear about it.
Do you think your paper has the resources to take that on?
I do. Do you?
Spotlight is the true story of how the Boston Globe uncovered the scandal of child molestation and the Catholic Church's attempt to cover it up. It's the investigation that rocked the entire church and the country.
And that's the kind of thing your team would do.
Spotlight.
The film stars Michael Keaton as Walter Robbie Robinson, the leader of the Spotlight team that uncovers the scandal.
We've got two stories here, a story about degenerate clergy and a story about a bunch of lawyers turning child abuse into a cottage industry.
Mark Ruffalo and Rachel McAdams each play reporters, and Stanley Tucci, the lawyer for the victims.
When you're a poor kid from a poor family, and when a priest pays attention to you, it's a big deal. How do you say no to God?
All are solid performances.
We understand.
The film's flaws are in the execution. Directed by Academy Award nominee Tom McCarthy, Spotlight feels more like a stage play than a feature film. This is a powerful film with great storytelling. It's just not that entertaining, but it's an important story that needs to be told. And for that reason, it's worth your movie dollar.
Ah, the holiday season.
Oh, yes.
Love the Coopers is the first of many Christmas films that will open soon. It's the story of four generations who come together for the annual Christmas Eve celebration. A series of unexpected visitors and unlikely events turns the night upside down.
This is the only time of the year when we're all together. I want everyone to have the memory of a perfect Christmas. Next stop.
Like Santa's stocking on Christmas morning, the film is filled with an all-star cast, including Olivia Wilde, Amanda Seyfried, Ed Helms, Marissa Tomei, John Goodman, and Diane Keaton. It's a story about being perfectly imperfect, but some of the imperfection goes a little too far. And while it longs to be a classic, Love the Coopers is far from becoming another It's a Wonderful Life. The beginning of the film is so unrelatable, it becomes irritating. Director Jesse Nelson wraps the film up in a perfect bow just in time to save it. You know, it's fun to watch Christmas films, but you might be better off watching just one more time, It's a Wonderful Life. Love the Coopers is not necessarily worth your movie dollar. For On the Screen, I'm Dawn Meadows-Dixon.